Tokenization at first might sound like a boring solved topic, but I hope to convince you that there are beautiful structures in there and that knowing more about this will help you in your NLP research. We first look at formalization of the most popular tokenizer, then we predict model success based on just a tokenization, and finally I'll show you how we got that wrong. This is not a usual research talk because I will not try to convince you to use our model or findings. Rather, I'll try to give you some deeper understanding of tokenization. Case in point, why it's relevant, there's thousands of papers about tokenization and also the NLP popstar Andrei Karpathy recently released a minimal implementation of BPE, which garnished a lot of attention. How do we represent text in a computer? A text editor might represent each letter individually, and we might take that representation to our sequence NLP models. For example, with one-hot encoding or embedding, we'll represent each letter individually. Now, what's the problem with that? What would be the embedding for letter H? That's kind of meaningless. In addition, a single sentence would be a sequence of 400 embeddings, which creates new issues down the line. Okay, so we represent each word separately. There is an embedding or index for each word that we saw in the training corpus. And again, what's the problem with that? If we didn't see the word pickles during training, then we would have no embedding to assign to it. And we converge to something between these two. Some repeating patterns that resemble morphemes are singular unit with an embedding. This way we have short sequences, meaningful units, and can represent unseen words. And finally, what's the problem with this? The problem is finding such units, but the answer to that are tokenization algorithms. How do we find this nice tokenization to meaningful units? We can start with morphology and decompose the words into morphemes. But this has some problems. It requires specific language knowledge, such as of English, and it cannot be applied to arbitrary texts. Also, this way we cannot control the granularity of the units. What we would want instead is something that is unsupervised and something where we can turn a knob to make the segmentation more or less aggressive, and in the result, the sequence is shorter or longer as we desire. And turns out, there is such a thing, and it's called byte pair encoding. How does it work? We start with each character being an individual unit. Then we look at the most common tuple. In this case, it's P and I. So we turn those into a single unit, PI. Then again, we look at what the most common tuple is. This time, it's C and K, so we turn those into CK. Once again, you look at what the most common pair of units is, and it's PI and CK, so we turn those into a single unit, PICK, pick. We repeat this until the number of units reaches some desired vocabulary size, because at each step we add a new, previously unseen unit to the vocabulary. And does this fulfill our requirements? Well, it is unsupervised because we did not use anything specific to English, and we could use the same thing for German or Python code. Also, it's granular because we can get any vocabulary size that we desire. BPE then transpired out of thin air and was initially invented for compression and not NLP. Let's look at what that means when we say that BPE is compression. We have a sequence of 27 characters and there are 12 unique characters in there. From information theory, we need about 4 bits per character and in total 108 bits. Now when we apply BPE, then we only have 14 units. At the same time, we increase the vocabulary size by the new units, so now we need 5 bits to transmit 1 unit. Still, this comes down to 70 bits for the whole sequence. This way, BPE saved us 38 bits. And by the way, if we ever zipped a file, then it likely used an LZW compression, which is very similar to how BPE works. Now we know that BPE is compression. However, there is one other aspect to BPE, and that this algorithm is greedy. For that, we need to write it down as an algorithm. We start with the text that we want to compress, or tokenize, which is the same thing. As the output, we want the compressed text, but also the sequence of merges, so that we can apply it also to new data. Then, as expected, we iterate m times, finding the most frequent pair, merge it, and loop again. This is how the output might look like, tokenized text and the sequence of merges that caused this. Now it should be clear to you what it means that BPE is greedy, because at each time step you look at what the currently most frequent pair is, and we take that one. Method we know that it is greedy will also show that it's not optimal in its greediness. Consider the sequence. The most frequent pair is A and B, so we merge it. Then A, B and A, so we merge it. After two greedy merges, we have a sequence of 5 units. However, if we were a bit smarter, then we would merge B and A first, and then B, A and A, resulting in a sequence of just 4 units. So in terms of compression, BPE does not guarantee the best merge sequence. However, we show that BPE is not arbitrarily suboptimal. What it means is that if we compute how many characters we save with BPE as opposed to optimal BPE, we get a lower bound, which is constant. This means that whatever adversarial sequence you give to BPE is going to be at least 1/3 as good as the optimal one. And from our experiments, human languages have nice Zipf-ian properties, and the merge sequence found by greedy BPE is roughly 99% as good as the optimal BPE. And you can read more about this in our paper, Formal Perspective on Byte Pair Encoding. Now we learned a lot about BPE, but there are many other tokenization algorithms or tweaks to BPE. And how do you know which one is the best one for a model? You might say, well, the best tokenization is the one that compresses the most. But that cannot be true, because this tokenization will just say each full word is its own unit, and we are back to square one. Then you can say that the best tokenization compresses the most such that there is no redundancy left. Computationally, this corresponds to maximizing entropy, because if the entropy is the highest, then there is nothing left to compress. Now let's build some intuition around why entropy would be a good predictor of tokenization quality. Here we have a tokenization and its unigram distribution. Each bar is a separate unit, and the height corresponds to how often it appears in the data. In the first case, the tokenization just tokenizes into sequence of letters, making the sequences super long. And that is not a good tokenization, because there is no specific meaning to each unit, but also that is heavily imbalanced. The letter A occurs much more frequently than the letter X. And because of this imbalance, the entropy of the distribution will be low. And this aligns perfectly with our intuition, because it is a proto-tokenization and our entropy predictor says the same thing. In the next one, we have a very large vocabulary. Each word is its own unit. That leads to poor generalization and also lower entropy again, because the distribution is imbalanced. The last one has meaningful units, and because it's imbalanced, closer to uniform distribution, has high entropy. In this case, both our intuition and the metric would select this one. There is one problem with maximizing entropy. Here we have two tokenizations and their unigram distributions. The entropy of the right one is higher, but that is contrary to our intuition, because that tokenization has lots of super low frequency units. This problem stems from the fact that we are comparing entropies of distributions with different vocabulary sizes. Luckily, there is entropy efficiency, and that is how much of the entropy potential is used. It's computed as the entropy optimal encoding of the present distribution divided by the optimal encoding of an uninformed distribution, which is the uniform one. It boils down to entropy divided by the vocabulary size logarithm. The entropy efficiency of the right distribution is lower than the one of the left, because it's wasting capacity on its long tail. All of this was based on intuition, but let's look at some empirical results. Here each point is a different tokenization, either from a different tokenizer or with some different type of parameters. On the y-axis, we have how well the machine translation, which is trained on the tokenized text, performed. Clearly, the tokenization affects the model performance a lot. On the x-axis, we have the tokenized sequence length, which was our first shot at a tokenization metric. We can see that there is some trend that the longer the sequence is, the worse the performance, so it is not a completely bad predictor. However, with the same setup, if the x-axis is our efficiency and a specific type of it, that seems to be a much better predictor of the performance. Indeed, across multiple tokenization metrics, our Rényi efficiency does the best and explains the biggest chunk of the variance. We'll not go into the details of Rényi efficiency, but I'll just note that it penalizes very high frequency and very low frequency units differently, which has some later implications. We packaged all of these metrics into a tool that you can install with pip. If you have two tokenized files, you can just invoke the tokenization scorer on both of them and it will give you a number, and the higher the number, the better. You can also do the same thing from within Python, and there are a few knobs and parameters that you can play with or extend. You can read about the fancier metric and all the maths behind it in the paper Tokenization and the Noiseless Channel. Now it seems that we solved tokenization. We understand how BPE works and what tokenization is the best one. Not short after we published our findings, I received this email with an ominous subject line. A few questions about tokenization and the Noiseless Channel. There are two bad things that can happen when you receive such an email. The first one is that someone tells you that your paper is wrong. The second one, even worse, is that they tell you they can prove it. It wasn't exactly like this. Instead, we began working together and were able to create some counterexamples to the hypothesis in the previous paper. Our hypothesis says that tokenization with a higher entropy efficiency will lead to a better model. So the counterexample to that hypothesis would be that we increase the efficiency but worsen the model. The mechanism for this is a bit technical but still simple. We take a very high frequency unit and create duplicates of it that have the same surface form but are represented as different embedding units. This increases the efficiency because we are flattening the unigram distribution because we are getting rid of very high frequency unit. At the same time, clearly, this also worsens the model because there is this added randomness. The implementation details are not as important as the results. For the original BPE, we have efficiency of 40%, but for the new adversarial one, we have efficiency of 50%. Our hypothesis from the second paper says that the model should also be better. However, the opposite is the case, making this a counterexample to our hypothesis. Now, do not despair, because this example was specifically crafted to break the hypothesis, and is very likely not going to occur in the wild. Yet it hints that there is some explained variance in the tokenization space that Rini efficiency doesn't take into account. I perceive this as an invitation for further research to find even better metrics that capture this. You can read about the details in the paper of my colleague. And this concludes our tokenization journey. I'd like to acknowledge all the people that were involved in these wonderful collaborations. And to summarize, we learned a lot about BPE through its formalization, that it's all compression under the hood, and that it's approximately optimal. From the tokenization part, we found a reliable metric that tells you which tokenization is the best one prior to training your expensive models. Looking forward, there is still a lot to explore in terms of these metrics, not just performance, but also aspects of multilinguality and bias. Finally, thank you for listening to me talk about tokenization.